is not at all how we thought it was supposed to be. We had so many plans for you, we had so many dreams, and now you've gone away and left us with the memories of your smile. And nothing we can say and nothing we can do can take away the pain of losing you. But we can cry with hope, we can say goodbye with hope, 'cause we know our goodbye is not the end. Oh no. And we can grieve with hope, 'cause we believe with hope there's a place where we'll see your face again. Never have I known anything so hard to understand, and never have I questioned more the wisdom of God's plan. But through the cloud of tears, I see the Father smile and say, well done. And I imagine you where you wanted most to be, seeing all your dreams come true, 'cause now you're home and now you're free. And we can cry with hope, we can say goodbye with hope, 'cause we know our goodbye is not the end. Oh no. And we can grieve with hope, 'cause we believe with hope there's a place where we'll an anchor, 'cause we believe that everything God promised us is true. So we can cry with hope, we can say goodbye with hope, 'cause we know our goodbye is not the end. Oh no. And we can grieve with hope, 'cause we believe there's a place by God's grace. There's a place where we'll see your face again.
Don't be mad if I cry, it just hurts so bad sometimes, 'cause every day it's sinking in, and I have to say goodbye all over again. You know, I bet it feels good to have the weight of this world off your shoulders now. I'm dreaming of the day when I'm finally there with you. Save a place for me. Save a place.
time.
I'll be there soon.
is not at all how we thought it was supposed to be. We had so many plans for you, we had so many dreams, and now you've gone away and left us with the memories of your smile. And nothing we can say and nothing we can do can take away the pain of losing you. But we can cry with hope, we can say goodbye with hope, 'cause we know our goodbye is not the end. Oh no. And we can grieve with hope, 'cause we believe with hope there's a place where we'll see your face again. So hard to understand, and never have I questioned more the wisdom of God's plan. But through the cloud of tears, I see the Father smile and say, well done. And I imagine you where you wanted most to be, seeing all your dreams come true. Now you're home and now you're free. And we can cry with hope, we can say goodbye with hope, 'cause we know our goodbye is not the end. Oh no. And we can grieve with hope, 'cause we believe with hope there's a place where we'll God promised us is true. So we can cry with hope, we can say goodbye with hope, 'cause we know our goodbye is not the end. Oh no. And we can grieve with hope, 'cause we believe with hope there's a place to play.
Save a place for me. Save a place for me. Don't be mad if I cry. It just hurts so bad sometimes. 'Cause every day it's sinking in, and I have to say goodbye all over again. You know I bet it feels good to have the weight of world off your shoulders now. I'm dreaming of the day when I'm finally there with you. Save a place for me. Save a place for me. I'll be there soon. I'll be there soon.
I'll be there soon. More the wisdom of God's plan. But through the cloud of tears, I see the Father smile and say, well done. And I imagine you where you wanted most to be, seeing all your dreams come true, 'cause now you're home and now you're free. We believe that everything God promised us is true, so we can cry with hope, we can say goodbye with hope, 'cause we know our goodbye is not the end. Oh no, and we can grieve with hope, 'cause we believe with hope there's a place where we'll see your face again. We'll see your face again. So we can cry with hope and say goodbye.
You know, I bet it feels good to have the weight of this world off your shoulders. And now I'm dreaming of the day when I'm finally there with you. Save a place for me. Save a place for me. I'll be there soon. I'll be there soon. Some grace for me. I'll be there soon.
This is not at all how we thought it was supposed to be. We had so many plans for you, we had so many dreams, and now you've gone away and left us with the memories of your smile, and nothing we can say and nothing we can do. Take away the pain of the...
I believe Laura and Bud are by themselves. That don't sound better than that. just can't leave Laura here.
Yeah, that's okay. My philosophy is if I take it off in the beginning, it'll be one of the last things kind of things. So, for a long run at the beginning of the track, I'll work my way out. Then I'll work my way back down. Get back to my phone. Okay, so, all right, that's what I do. I'll work my way back down.
Thank you. We're thankful to have you with us today. We're thankful that you could join us to celebrate Janice's life and the gift that she has been to so many of us. As you may know, today is 1 year exactly since we lost Janice. And it's been a hard year. I know for many of us, it's like she went to Florida and we're waiting for her to come back. And so it's good for us to be together to offer some comfort and to share some memories. I hope you got a chance to view the photos that were out front and to say hello and give some hugs. That's what today is really about. Today is about us coming together to share love and comfort, to share memories. Mourning is always difficult, but it's especially difficult when we do it alone. And this year, with everything we've dealt with, it's made it all the more difficult. So thank you for being here today, and ask that you join me as we pray together. Father God, thank you for this day. Thank you for the joy that we've been able to share. Thank you for the photos, for the memories, for the laughs. Thank you for the gift that Janice has been to so many. And Father, your word tells us that we are not to mourn as the world mourns, that we are not to mourn as those without hope. And so, Father, I pray that today you would help us to mourn with hope, that even as we are sad that Janice is not with us, as we miss her, especially as the different milestones of the years come by, I know, Father, when VBS comes around, we're going to miss having her with us. But, Father, please give us your comfort. Give us the comfort of your Holy Spirit and the comfort of being together. And Father, help us to rest in the knowledge that Janice is with you. We know that to be absent from the body is to be present with you. And Father, we hold on to that hope now that she is with you, smiling and singing and well. So Father, help us to hold on to that comfort as we join together today. In Jesus' precious and holy name I pray. Amen. I'd like to begin the service today by sharing a passage from Scripture, from Psalm 23. The book of Psalms is a wonderful book. It helps us. It helps us get through our moments. There are Psalms to help us celebrate, and there are Psalms when we're confused, and of course there are Psalms when we hurt, when we mourn. And Psalm 23 is one that I particularly love because it reminds us who God is for us, and that God is always there with us. So I'll be sharing here, actually, from the New Living Translation. It's a little bit different than some of us memorized, but I like the way they end it. So please hear this Psalm of David, Psalm 23. David says, "The Lord is my shepherd, and I have all that I need. He lets me rest in green meadows, and he leads me beside peaceful streams. He renews my strength. He guides me along right paths, bringing honor to his name. Even when I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will not be afraid, for you are close beside me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a feast for me in the presence of my enemies. You honor me by anointing my head with oil. My cup overflows with blessings. Surely your goodness and unfailing love will pursue me all the days of my life, and I will live in the house of the Lord forever." I love how the New Living Translation states verse 6, that the goodness and unfailing love of God will pursue us all the days of our lives. That no matter where we go, no matter what happens to us, no matter what choices we make for good or for ill, no matter what curveballs life throws at us, that God is always with us. Now, of course, it's not that hard to feel God with us when we're in the meadow, when we're by the stream being refreshed, having rest, being restored. But it's in that valley when we need these words. It's when we're in the valley, when we miss, when we hurt, when we recognize that the world is not as it should be. You know, death was not God's intention. In the garden, when God made things originally, there was no death. It's because of sin and the curse that we have that experience now. But again, our hope is not in this life. Our hope is not in these bodies. Our bodies all grow weak and grow frail, especially as we age. Our hope is in a God that loves us, a promise of resurrected bodies, bodies that will not age or deteriorate, of a world where we will be one with God, where there will be no more sorrow, no more pain, no more tears, where God will be with us and we will be his children. And today, even as we mourn the loss of Janice, we celebrate that she gets to be a part of that, that she no longer has to deal with a broken world with pain, that she gets to be present with the Lord. And we look forward to the day when we get to join her. But for now, while we're in this world dealing with terrible days, terrible losses, like the loss of a mother or a grandmother, we remember that God is with us. And I believe that one of the most poignant, one of the most emotional ways that God shows his presence with us is by helping us to show love to one another. That we can come together and hug or, you know, socially distant high five. That we can come together in a place, share memories, and remember that we're not alone. We're not alone in our pain, but also that we are not alone in our memories. And that's a very important thing to point out. You see, pain often shouts, and that tends to get our attention, but it's the joy and the love that we have to nurture like a garden. That's something that this psalm does for us. It helps us nurture that love. And of course, it's still very soon. Even though it's been a year, that's still a very short time. But as time goes on, we nurture that joy. We nurture the memories of the gift of Janice. I know for me, coming to this church as a new pastor, she was one of the first people that I got to sit down and have conversations with. To sit down, especially at our Sunday night Bible study. And you'll hear more of this later, but at least for me, Janice was famous for having notes in her Bible. And she would always sit down and she'd open the Bible and pull out her piece of paper and say, "Pastor, I was reading something." And didn't know it was going to come next, but you knew it was going to be interesting. And her presence is something that touched the lives of many people. Of course, immediate family, you got to spend the most time with her, but we were very privileged as a church family to have Janice be part of our extended family here. And generations of people were touched by her presence and her love, especially her care for children. And we're thankful. We're thankful to you for sharing her with us and that we got to experience that joy as well. And it's that joy, those memories that we hold on to. I think keeping her alive in that way is a part of how God's love pursues us. That he reminds us that no matter what pain we experience, that cannot take away our joy. That love is greater than loss. And even though we don't get to see Janice face to face today, we will again. The pain will be erased and the love will be forever. That's what the Apostle Paul says in 1 Corinthians chapter 13, the love chapter. He says, these three will remain, faith, hope, and love, but the greatest is love. That love lasts forever. Yes, amen. We have a couple of songs we're going to be sharing today as part of our service, two in particular that were close to Janice's heart. So if you'd like to stand and sing, you'd be welcome to do that. If you'd like to sit, you can do that as well. Our first song, make sure I don't say the wrong one here. Our first song is The Old Rugged Cross. Pastor, what was that page number? That's page 233 in the hymnal. If you would like to pull a hymnal from the back of the pew in front of you, page 233. This is an old favorite of Janice's, and I hope that along with us you get to remember her as we sing it. Thank you, Vicky, for helping us. Now in the service, we're going to have a few moments to share. We have a few family members who would like to get up and share, and you will have a chance in just a moment to come up and share if you would like. I just want to give a quick note that we are recording the service for those who couldn't be here, so if you could stand here in the middle and speak into the microphone, that would help us. Terry, I believe you're up first, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, Pastor. Can you hear me in this mask? I will never get used to these things, but is that a yes?
Turn. No? I can turn, yep.
Yes, in the back? That's better. Good afternoon. On behalf of my family, I would like to thank you for sharing this time with us. As Pastor said, I am Terry, son number 3, and as my siblings would say, mom's favorite, for some reason. 1 year ago today, I received a call that no one is usually ready to receive. I had to answer questions, make decisions from hundreds of miles away. The result, mom had passed away in Florida. Evidently, a hemorrhage in the brain leading to cardiac arrest, and now with an understanding of those events, I am somewhat comforted in knowing that she passed suddenly and did not suffer. Knowing the relationship that mom had with the Lord, I am 100% confident that the two of them had a mutual agreement that when he was ready for her, it would be processed quickly as it was. The COVID pandemic limited our ability to truly say goodbye at that time. Our lives have moved forward, and I have dealt with the busyness of mom's affairs, but there has been a missing gap or hole, at least for me, needing some reflection and a true goodbye. Although it's been a year, it makes today's process no easier. So if necessary, please bear with me as I share with you who my mother was, the lessons she instilled in mostly in an indirect way, if not direct, and the unique life of Janice. Perseverance and accomplishments. In a snapshot, mom was born as what we would probably call today an accident. Had an older sister that died before she knew her, and older brothers that were off to war and life well before she was even school age. As a young adult, barely with her own 2 young children, she lost her own mother and never knew a dad. Mom's perseverance in life continued through 2 husbands and a 3rd life partner, Jake, of over 28 years. Now, most of you women are probably thinking one man was more than enough. Just imagine coursing through life with 3. The perseverance just continues with the raising of 5 children, include 4 stepchildren, eventually grandchildren, which really adds the spice to life and which I will expand upon shortly. In her 40s, mom put herself through cosmetology school, where she eventually became a well-known hairdresser and barber within the Pennsville community over the next 30 years. At the age of 50, mom went to college. I have to say that I was proud to see how excited my mom was when she would show me her papers and how she was getting good grades in Composition 101. Although she may have needed a little help with the algebra, and as she would say, this isn't how they taught math when I was in school, I am in awe of how she successfully completed some of the initial college courses. Life itself was not without hardships. A family fire that destroyed all the belongings. And most significantly, a few years ago, mom had to unfortunately endure what I can only imagine is the hardest thing a parent would have to face. And something as a parent myself, I pray I will never have to do, as she buried my sister, Karina. Reflecting on this brief overview of mom's life and some of these events, I see courage, dedication, and faith. As we all do, mom had her challenges at times in life, and when necessary, she picked up the pieces and moved on. I know she relied on her faith in the Lord, which she developed young in life and continually grew in. And as the saying goes, mom was given lemons at times, and she was successful at turning them into lemonade. I am proud to look at some of the parts of my mom's life and to see what she has accomplished. Later in life, Mom did pick up a bit of an adventurous spirit with her partner, Jake, as they took trips to Maine, Florida, across the country. It was exciting to hear Mom's stories and to see the pictures of the things she experienced on these trips. Eventually, the Florida trips led to her next courageous move, a home in Florida with Jake, which started as the winter getaway and was becoming the permanent home. And on to the duties of Mom. As I mentioned, raising five children, four stepchildren in that process, eventually grandchildren, that in itself is a 1,000-page novel, full of love, laughter, lessons, sometimes worries and tears. It is hard to discuss them all, but of course there were the doctor and hospital visits with broken bones and stitches. There were the school events and sporting events, homeworks, but there were also the calls from the police, the parties, unwanted knocks on the door from neighbors complaining, a truck driver trying to find those boys who just took target practice on his tractor trailer as he was driving by. There was me who decided to run into the pathway of a car. My brother who decided it would be fun to have a citywide search for the missing boy and even a teenage pregnancy. The bottom line is Mom earned her stripes. As a young boy, she comforted me and provided me with security, and she answered every stupid little question I may have had. As a child, I sometimes wondered what she was thinking as she looked out that window on Pennsylvania Avenue and saw me and my brother pretending we were now Evel Knievel with our big wheel or our bikes, stacking up cinder blocks with a wooden board to see how far we could make the next jump. I think she taught her lessons in the process of, let's throw them in the pool and see how they swim. Because as she watched us, I hope she used to think that I'm sure they won't hurt themselves. When she probably seen us laying down neighborhood kids and they were the buses that we were gonna jump over instead of Evel Knievel, I'm sure that kind of put a little light bulb in her brain there. But again, some of that adventurous spirit might have worn off. You know, as she allowed, she stood back and allowed us to experience life. As a teenager, I often wonder how she tolerated some of the things that my brother and I, me and my friends, our friends would put her through. How she tolerated our house becoming the hangout and the party episode. How she literally probably ended up adopting four of my friends who just thought that house was theirs, would come and go and pleased. Ultimately, she was a trooper. Mom loved her family and her children. Game night with the family was a huge deal. The laughter, I've heard my mom, you know, from ringing a bell, playing the game of pit, will probably echo in my ears forever. As a young adult, I am fortunate enough to have experienced an independent time in my mom's life, I guess you could say, where, you know, I got to know her not just as a mom, but as a person, as a human being. I've experienced her having joy and true happiness. There's never enough time, especially when things happen as they do. But I am thankful for many things. Lessons that I look back and on myself, I've gotten from my mother. I am thankful that she was a God-loving, God-fearing, church-going person that dragged me to church throughout life, gave me a basis in understanding the importance of having a relationship with the Lord. I'm sure there's a million things that I will think I wanted to say when I leave. But I am thankful for the mother that I have had. I am thankful for what she has taught me, directly or indirectly. I am thankful for the experience that she has provided. Mom, I love you, and I will see you again.
Thank you, Terry. Thank you. Howard, would you like to transition?
Thank you. So I have to try to do this following Pastor and Terry. So the reason why I didn't prepare anything is because I figured everything would be said by the time I came up here, which it was. I'm going to just read something that, while I've been sitting there and I've been talking and thinking about this since we met, really just kind of struck me. And what I'm actually going to read is like the parable of the sower, I should say. A farmer went out to sow his seed. As he was scattering the seed, some fell along the path, and the birds came and ate it up. Some fell on rocky places where it did not have much soil. It sprang up quickly because the soil was shallow. But when the sun came up, the plants were scorched and they withered because they had no root. Other seed fell among thorns, which grew up and choked the plants. Still other seed fell on good soil where it produced a crop 160 or 30 times what was sown. Who has ears, let him hear. The reason why that just kind of came to me is as we talked about everything and we look back on everything, you know, it's been a year. I honestly don't think Mom would have stood there with this mask on and we would have heard that. We would have heard that little, I don't know what it is with these masks or whatever it would have been. We would have heard that. I mean, she would have been on the phone every day telling us how much I just think it's stupid, you know, or just something like that. The reason that parable came to me is the time I spent from being a kid up through the craziest times and everything in there, one thing Mom was always doing was planting a seed. She was the happiest person with the smallest little things around her. Went to Florida when she had the house down there, and it's sitting in the back of the car with her and Jake just arguing over which way to go and everything. And the things that she wants to point out is, oh, that's where the bank is, you know? And it's like, it's this tiny little bank, but that's who she was. It was just the smallest little things, and she just spread it all over. Yeah, were we crazy as teenagers? Did we put her through a lot? Did she join in with us? Absolutely. You know, she was always pursuing that relationship with God, but she had her struggles. You know, she sat back a lot of times, and she really she was always seeking an answer. She had some regrets. She battled with her own sin and everything like that. But she planted so much in us in the way that she went about things. You know, as much as you would sit there and you would hear it sometimes and you knew she was going to have an opinion that you really didn't want to hear, you listened. And when you got done, she had planted a seed. You know, and a lot of us, it was like that. You know, so a year of time looking back on it, I mean, we've grieved, we've done everything, and a lot of us, you know, we've had a lot of time to come to terms with it, which hasn't been easy, but it's been enlightening in a lot of ways. And I think the point and where this really just weighed on my heart today and was in there is that's what she always wanted. She didn't expect us to be perfect. She didn't expect us to get everything right. She made her own mistakes, and she knew we were going to make our mistakes. And what she's looking for from all of us was just, she just kept planting that seed. You know, for her to be here and see me actually stand up in front of the church, open the Bible, and read a passage that came to me probably would have shocked her to no end. When I started, you know, because I battled with her all the time. You know, you talk about the Bible being open with all the notes. I think some of those notes she was just writing up because she knew I was going to come over one day, and when I did, she was going to be ready. You know, and it struck. I mean, when I first started going and attending church, people questioned because I had a lot of questions. And they said, well, you sure know the Bible for somebody who's not sure if they even believe. I said, well, it's been drilled into me for my whole life. I mean, it's not like I didn't read it. But it's those types of seeds. And you guys and everybody here that's had the experience, and I know there's grandkids, great-grandkids, and the littlest ones, and there's great-grandchildren out there. You know, it's our job to carry it on. You don't have to be perfect. You don't have to walk it. You just have to remember what she was about and plant those seeds. They only spring up for a short time because the soil isn't deep. At least they sprung for a little while. You know, so just in our walk, the best thing we can ever do for her is just continue to try to walk and plant seeds as she did as we went along. And I will leave it with that.
Man. So I have a poem for my grandma. Your love and kindness were so special, and your heart so pure and true. You made this world a better place just by being you. I miss you, Grandma, so dearly. I wish you were here with me to find and collect cute turtle stuff that we may see. I wish you were here with me to help guide me through the years, to be the person that I always wanted to be. Words cannot describe the loss that I feel having to say this last goodbye, not to have you here with me to wipe my tears from my eyes. My beautiful grandma, you will never be forgotten, for you are in my heart where you will always be. Until we meet again, Grandma, I will keep your memory safe with me.
Thank you so much. That was beautiful.
Would anyone else like a chance to share? Share a memory, share a story? Thank you very much. It was beautiful. And hearing these stories, it makes us cry because of the things we miss. But it also makes us smile because of the things we remember. I don't think this is an unknown thing to say to anyone, but in my experience, Janice was never a shy person.
Oh, no.
She was never a shy person. And I think, Howard, the way you said it, somebody who was always asking and always planting. Yeah. Or Terry, the way you shared, someone who was there who didn't judge you, who was there to show love. Somebody who knew what it was to be wounded by life and was willing to share some love because of that. Some beautiful, beautiful memories. Like I said, I was blessed to get to know Janice just briefly. But even our little bit less than a year together before she went to Florida, she made such a deep impression. You know, Howard mentioned the notes. She was somebody who was always had a Bible full of notes. She was always highlighting and writing and asking, and, well, I heard this preacher on TV say this thing, or, Pastor, you mentioned this, but I read this other thing. And we were blessed with some wonderful conversations. I know that Janice is a person who deeply loves the Lord. I know that her spiritual walk was a deep part of her life, and it was a place where she found solace, where she found peace, where she found encouragement and love. And one of the things I'd like to say in my time to share here is to not forget that. Some of the best things that we know about Janice are because she had faith. That's what kept her heart going. That's what kept her loving after she'd been through hard times. And I'm sorry if this stings a little, but the suddenness of her passing is a reminder to us that life is short. Like many of you, when she left for Florida, we expected to see her back. You know, I don't think any of us expected that that goodbye would be the last face-to-face goodbye. But sometimes that's what life happens. Sometimes that happens in life, and I want to remind you that for those important things, for those relationships that you want to mend, for those I love yous that you felt the urge to share but you didn't make the call yet, for the hugs that you thought about giving but didn't, for the times to get right with God that you've been putting off, don't put it off. Don't wait, because we never know what's going to happen. We never know what tomorrow's going to bring. You know, for those cousins or friends you might be seeing in this room right now that you haven't talked to in 20 years, give a hug, exchange a phone number. When you say you're going to get together for lunch, make sure you do it. Outside and socially distanced again, but you know, make sure you do it. When we spoke, one of the, I think, funny things about Janice is you couldn't really pick a favorite Bible verse for her because her favorite Bible verse was kind of the Bible. It was kind of the whole thing. But a passage that Howard brought up, which I think is a wonderful place to start our conversation now, and I think she'd be pleased that you thought of it, is from the book of Ecclesiastes, a book of wisdom, a book that gives us guidance when we're trying to figure things out. I'll be reading from Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verses 1 through 8. For everything there is a season, a time for every activity under heaven. There is a time to be born and a time to die, a time to plant and a time to harvest, a time to kill and a time to heal, a time to tear down and a time to build up. There is a time to cry and a time to laugh. There is a time to grieve and a time to dance. There is a time to scatter stones and a time to gather stones. There is a time to embrace and there is a time to turn away. There is a time to search and a time to stop searching, a time to keep and a time to throw away, a time to tear and a time to mend, a time to be quiet and a time to speak, a time to love and a time to hate, a time for war and a time for peace. There's a time to cry and a time to laugh. The funny thing about life is sometimes those times are the same time, times like today. Times when we cry because it hurts. And I want to tell you that's a good thing. It's good that it hurts. Not that we enjoy the hurt, but the hurt's a reminder of our love. We hurt because we love Janice and because we miss her. And our pain and the tears we shed today are a testament to her character as a person, to who she was and how she lived. She is missed. She is loved. She will always be loved. I was thinking as I read this verse and as I prepared, this really does sum up life. There are those seasons like in this passage or even what David shared in Psalm 23. There are times by the meadow, the beautiful rest times, the times that you take pictures of and put on a board, right? But we also have those seasons when we're hurt. You know, I think anybody who knew Janice knew the pain she felt losing her daughter, Karina, you know? And she carried that wound. She carried that wound. But she also carried love, both these things at the same time, you know? Joy and pain, laughter and tears, love and hurt, all together. And I think that she would want us to smile today. I think that she would want us to think of the silliness and her humor, that she'd want to think of collecting the turtles, right? Think of those moments of joy and hold on to them because they are precious. They are precious moments in our lives that we hold in our hearts, that we carry with us, that nothing can ever take away. No valley, no pain that we face will ever take away her love for us. You know, as our brother Job said when he faced a time of loss, the Lord gives and the Lord takes away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Now, I don't think Job was thanking God for the pain he felt, but I think he was trying to remind us that in our time of loss, it's still a time to say thank you, that we had something to lose. We mourn because of love, and that love is a gift. And your mother was a wonderful person. And not everybody gets a mother like her. Not everybody has a mother who is willing to forgive and love and understand. And that's a beautiful love that leaves a mark, that plants a seed, that plants a seed in all of our lives. You know, from a spiritual perspective, this is part of our journey. All of our journeys are going to have the mountaintop experiences and the dark valley pains. But something that Scripture teaches us and something that we hold on days like today is that in both of those cases, in all of these cases, God's love is with us. Nothing can ever take that. As a word of comfort, I'd like to share from the book of Romans, chapter 8, verses 29 through 39. This is the Apostle Paul speaking. He said, "For God knew his people in advance, and he chose them to become like his son, so that his son would be the firstborn among many brothers and sisters. And having chosen them, he called them to come to him. And having called them, he gave them right standing with himself. And having given them that right standing, he gave them his glory. And what can we say about such wonderful things as these? If God is for us, who could ever be against us? Since he did not spare even his own son, but gave him up for us all, won't he also give us everything else? Who could dare accuse us whom God has chosen for his own? No one, for God himself has given us right standing with himself. Who then will condemn us? No one. For Christ Jesus died for us and was raised to life for us, and he is sitting in the place of honor at God's right hand, pleading for us, like a mother pleading for her family. Can anything ever separate us from Christ's love? Does it mean he no longer loves us if we have trouble or calamity, or are persecuted, or hungry, or destitute, or in danger, or even threatened with death? No, despite all these things, overwhelming victory is ours through Christ who loves us. And I'm convinced that nothing can ever separate us from God's love. Neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither our fears for today nor our worries for tomorrow, not even the powers of hell can separate us from God's love. No power in the sky above or on the earth below. Indeed, nothing in all creation will ever be able to separate us from the love of God that is revealed in Christ Jesus our Lord." This love is what we hold on to. You heard the words Paul said. Does it mean God doesn't love us when we have pain? No. When we have pain, that's our time to lean on God, to lean on that help, to lean on that love, to lean on that hope. You know, faith and hope are precious things. Faith and hope are really about trusting in the things that we can't see or can't feel. Trusting that the people we lose, like a mother or a daughter, that we can be reunited with them one day. That Jesus was the first fruit of a great harvest, and like verse 29 says, that he would bring many brothers and sisters into his family. That's what I remember. That's something Janice was passionate about, that people would know love. As much as she focused on the Bible, I think that was even more important to her, to know love. I came to this church in July, just a week before Bible school, and so of course, when I got here, I didn't know anybody. And trying to learn all the faces and names at Bible school was a bit overwhelming. But Janice was one of our volunteers who was in charge of the registration table. And so I got to kind of hang around at the registration table because they had name tags on, and so I knew who everybody was. And she and I got to chat during that week, a pretty crazy, exhausting week. And she was so excited getting to register names that she didn't know, kids that she hadn't met who came to church who could hear the story. You know, I got to hear some wonderful stories from some of the ladies in our church about Janice when she first came here and how she learned a lot of those Bible stories by helping out with children's church, by helping teach the kids. These are beautiful memories of a life well lived, of a wonderful gift of a person. And we have to say thank you for that. We have to say thank you for such a wonderful gift. But again, in our pain, we also need to come together and love each other. I think that's what she'd want. I think she would want hugs. She'd probably want some smiles too. This love that is revealed in Jesus, I hope you know it. I hope you do. And I think Janice would kick me if I didn't mention here, if you don't have it, you can. You don't have to go another day without it. God doesn't care what you've done or where you've been. He made you and he loves you and he desires a relationship with you. All the judgment and baggage and crap that people pile onto it, God loves you. God loves you and he wants you. He wants to forgive you and be in relationship with you. And I know Janice would want you to be reminded of that in this moment, that you are loved. We're going to sing another song in just a moment. We have a couple volunteers who are going to pass out the words. This one is not in the hymnal. Oh, it is in the hymnal. 658. All right. Well, we also have some copies, so we're going to, you can grab a hymnal or grab some copies of those words. Oh, well, thank you so much. So 658, we are doubly blessed. See, Janice knew the hymnal better than I did, so I didn't think this one was in here. But this song, it's called Sweet By and By, and even though we're going to sing these words in just a second, I want to just let you hear the words of the first verse. There is a land that is fairer than day, and by faith we can see it afar. For the Father waits over the way to prepare us a dwelling place there. In the sweet by and by, we shall meet on that beautiful shore. In the sweet by and by, we shall meet on that beautiful shore. That's the hope that we rest in today. So I'd invite you to stand and join us as we sing hymn number 658. Sweet By and By. It's a beautiful song of hope that God has prepared a beautiful place of rest and love for us, a place where we will be reunited both with our Savior and with our loved ones to join together for eternity. It's that moment of eternity that I'd like to share with you as we close today. I'd like to share a passage from the book of Revelation. Now, you might think that the book of Revelation is a scary book, and I did too before I got into it, but Revelation talks about a journey through the scary parts to the blessing that comes after. And that's kind of what faith is, right? A journey through the hard parts to get to the blessing that comes later. I'd like to read from chapter 21, verses 1 through 7. And then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the old heaven and the old earth had disappeared, and the sea was also gone. And I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down from God out of heaven like a bride beautifully dressed for their husband. I heard a loud shout from the throne saying, "Look, God's home is now among his people. He will live with them, and they will be his people. God himself will be with them. He will wipe every tear from their eyes, and there will be no more death or sorrow or crying or pain. All these things are gone forever." And the one sitting on the throne said, "Look, I am making all things new." And then he said to me, "Write this down, for what I tell you is trustworthy and true." And he also said, "It is finished. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. To all who are thirsty, I will give freely from the springs of the water of life. All who are victorious will inherit all these blessings, and I will be their God, and they will be my children." I chose to share this passage at the end of our time together today because it offers a word of hope. It recognizes that life is hard, that we go through pain and there is loss, but it also recognizes that God's coming to fix things, that Jesus is coming back, and when he does, all these things, the wrongness of death and pain, the wrongness of tears, they'll be wiped away. They will be gone forever, and things will be made right. We'll meet together in the air, and we will dance and sing and celebrate a beautiful family reunion. So as we gather to mourn, as we cry, remember that. Remember that there is still hope and there is still love. That God loves you, that God loves Janice, and that he wants us all to be together, to be part of his family. The pain that we feel today, it can be so strong that it overwhelms everything else. And for a time, I think that's where we all are. We're in a place where our grief overwhelms us. But as you have time to heal, as you have time to move forward with your lives, I hope that some of that joy and love will creep back in. That the beautiful memories, the laughter will start to outweigh that terrible phone call. And I do believe we'll get there together as we support each other, as we love each other, as we lift each other up when we stumble, as we care for one another, as God called us to, and as I'm sure Janice would. As I close the service today, I'm going to be sharing a prayer. And towards the end of the prayer, I will be praying the Lord's Prayer. And so when we get to that part of the prayer, if you would like to join me in that prayer, you're very welcome to do so. So please join me in prayer. Father God, for as much as we know Janice's spirit has departed and returned to you, we tenderly commit her body to you in the trust of the resurrection of the dead and in the life in the world to come through our Lord Jesus Christ. And Father, we have that hope that we will be given new bodies like unto his glorious body, that we will meet in the air, and that we will sing and dance in celebration. Father, help us to hold on to that hope. Help us to remember the love that we have, Father. Help us to cherish the love that Janice herself gave us and the love that we shared with her together. Father, as we mourn, help us to keep that spark of love alive. Help us to fan it by our presence together, by our care for one another, by offering comfort, by offering memories. Father, help us to rest in the joy of the gift that Janice has been to so many. And now we will pray the prayer that Jesus himself taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. As you leave today, I pray that you will go in the grace and love of our Lord Jesus Christ, and that his Spirit may comfort you. As we finish our time together today, I'd invite you to come up to say a goodbye, to share a memory, to offer some hugs to Janice's children. And we will be joining together for a time of fellowship. If you'd like to head down the hallway, we'll be meeting in the gym for some food, and then we have tables set up outside so everybody can eat outdoors. We know that the corona stuff's an issue. People are a little worried about that, but we have beautiful weather. God has blessed us with a wonderful day. So we hope that you can stay and join friends and family as we remember Janice and offer some comfort to each other. Thank you for coming today, and God bless you.